सभी को नमस्कार, मैं ऋचा मिश्रा बोल रही
दिस
हूँ।
कॉल इज नाउ बीइंग रिकॉर्डेड।
आशा है आप सबको मेरी आवाज सुनाई दे रही होगी। हेलो, नमस्कार। हीरालाल मेमोरियल कॉलेज में बैठे हुए सभी मित्रों, बंधुओं और विद्यार्थियों को मेरा बहुत बहुत नमस्कार। एंड इट इज अ ग्रेट प्लेजर फॉर मी टू एड्रेस यू ऑल टुडे, स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ सच प्रेस्टिजियस कॉलेज। हीरालाल मेमोरियल कॉलेज इज सिचुएटेड इन दक्षिणेश्वर, दैट आई हैव कम टू नो। एंड इट इज रिलेटेड टू द हिस्ट्री ऑफ कैलकटा, टू कालीबारी and to of course Ramkrishna ji was hailed from that place only. So it is a great pleasure for me to address you all today. दिल्ली में बैठ के मैं आप सब से जुड़ पा रही हूँ, बातचीत कर पा रही हूँ, ये मेरे लिए बहुत ही आनंद का विषय है। और आशा है, आई होप दैट एवरीबडी इज लिसनिंग टू मी लाउड एंड क्लियर। Am I audible? If any one participant can message me that I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you so much. So, in today's lecture, I will try to present before you the immense contribution of the Bhakti poets. Is anybody else coming and presenting something?
Yes, ma'am. Please, please wait 5 minutes. Okay.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
মধুমিতা দি, শ্রেয়সী, অ্যাম আই অডিবল? প্রিন্সিপাল ম্যাম জয়েন্ট? মধুমিতা দি,
হ্যাঁ শ্রেয়সী, শোনা যাচ্ছে, তোমাকে শোনা যাচ্ছে।
প্রিন্সিপাল ম্যাম জয়েন্ট?
দাঁড়াও দেখছি ম্যামকে। তো ম্যাম তো ছিলেন, মানে
অ্যাকচুয়ালি ইন্ট্রোডাকশন উড বি ডান বাই প্রদীপ্ত স্যার।
আই নো ভেরি ইজ প্রদীপ্ত, প্রদীপ্ত ছিলেন।
Before, yes, I am here, but before we start, there must be a formal inauguration, na?
ওকে, দেন শুড আই স্টার্ট?
Sure, go ahead, madam.
মিলেনা জি নমস্কার।
পিকচার নিয়ে আছে, দেখো।
ওকে
আচ্ছা, চলো আমি করে নিচ্ছি।
ওকে
এখানে এখানে এখানে
আর নাও আই এম স্টার্টিং। গুড ডে,
প্রিন্সিপাল ম্যাম কি থাকবেন সেটা কি
আই হ্যাভ
জানতে পেরেছো?
অলরেডি I have already sent my text message by WhatsApp to Principal Ma'am, but received no answer.
আচ্ছা, ওকে ওকে, ইটস অলরেডি 12:06, সো শুড বি বিগিন প্রদীপ্ত
Yes, madam, we should.
উইদাউট ম্যাম? ওকে ওকে, দেন গো অ্যাহেড শ্রেয়সী, ইউ জাস্ট বি মেক দি ইন্ট্রোডাকশন।
Thank you, ma'am. Good day. Welcome to the extension lecture program jointly organized by History and Hindi Department of HMMCW in collaboration with IQAC. Today, we all are here for a special web talk which would be delivered by respected Dr. Richa Mishra, Associate Professor Hindi of Sri Venkateswaraya College, University of Delhi. Honorable speaker ma'am would deliver her valuable lecture on the theme entitled Kobir and Mira, Bhakti Movements and its socio-cultural impact on medieval India. Now I would very humbly request webinar organizing committee chief Pradipto sir to deliver his introductory lecture to enlighten us. Pradipto sir, please continue.
Namaskar Richa madam, and good afternoon to everybody. So we have the honor to have with us Madam Richa Sharma, who is a postdoctoral associate professor of Hindi Sri Venkatesh College, University of Delhi. She has obtained 5 gold medals at graduate and postgraduate level. And she is known Russian, Marathi and Sanskrit besides Hindi and English. Well, madam, thank you. She has authored 5 books and several articles. And she has traveled, including London, Prague, Germany, Russia, USA, and many other foreign nations. She availed CWIT grant from British Council for Postdoctoral Research and served as visiting professor of Hindi at Tokyo University and of Foreign Studies from April 2017 to September 2018. With this brief introduction, may I request our honorable IQC coordinator, Dr. Rupa Sen, to say a few words about the webinar. Madam Dr. Rupa Sen, to welcome Professor Richa Sharma.
Thank you, Pradipto. Good afternoon and a very warm welcome to all participants. Our much revered speaker today, Dr. Richa Sharma, Associate Professor of Delhi University, our honored guests and friends of our fraternity and beyond, and my dear students. Well, it's time we gear up and get transported to the medieval period to meet Mirabai and Kabir, learning and unlearning their contributions to Indian political thought and ideas. I'm sure all of us will enjoy thoroughly the journey that is about to begin, and it will be led by our honorable speaker today. It's truly a pleasure to have you, ma'am, with us. The rest, I think all of us are getting impatient and waiting to hear from you. Ma'am, you're requested to begin.
Yeah, thank you.
Sorry for interrupt. She is Richa Mishra, not Richa Sharma. Sorry, ma'am. Sorry.
It's okay. It's fine. नाम में क्या रखा है कोई बात नहीं. धन्यवाद रूपा जी और धन्यवाद प्रदीप जी, आपने बहुत अच्छे से हमारा परिचय दिया. आप सभी का धन्यवाद. और मैं आई अगेन वांट टू थैंक यू ऑल टू कॉल मी फॉर टू डिलीवर दिस लेक्चर बिकॉज मैं इतना दूर बैठ के फ्रॉम दिल्ली कनेक्टिंग टू कैलकटा एंड दैट टू कालीवाड़ी एंड दक्षिणेश्वर टेम्पल इज सच ए पॉजिटिव vibes I am getting from all around. So thank you again. आप सभी को नमस्कार है और आप सभी को प्रणाम. और अब since today's lecture is about Kabir and Mira, so I would try to present you before you the immense contribution of the Bhakti poets in bringing the Indian society together through their works. And since the topic has a special reference to Kabir and Mira, I will primarily focus on their works. But before we come to their literature and Kabir and Mira's works, we should understand very briefly the socio-political scene of the medieval period. And that all of us know is about from 15th to 17th century. And in which in literature we call is at Bhakti Kal. Okay. When all the great Bhakti poets were born. So it was the time of, politically, it was the time of Mughal rule in India. And as we all know, it had brought the entire subcontinent under one domain. But it was marred by Hindu-Muslim conflicts. And as we all know from the historical fact that the Muslim invaders had been waging warfare up and down the subcontinent, taking our kingdoms and propagating their faith to the point of the sword. During the time of the great poet Tulsidas, you all know about Tulsidas, his Ramcharitmanas and all. So during his time, Akbar had already taken control of Delhi and Lahore, Gwalior, and vast areas of North India. So the violence which accompanied these conquests is a well-known historical fact. Therefore, जैसा कि हम सब समझ सकते हैं कि the Hindu society was under great stress, and to save their faith, what we call is Hinduism, they started to develop a sort of defense mechanism of rigid religious practices and orthodoxy. थोड़ा मैं हिंदी में भी बोलूंगी क्योंकि कुछ हिंदी के बच्चे भी हैं कि जिस समय मुगल शासन ने हिंदुओं पर और भारत पर अपने कड़े धर्म का प्रचार करना शुरू किया, उस समय जो हिंदू धर्म था उसमें अपने नियम कठोर बनाने शुरू किए जिससे कि वो अपनी सुरक्षा कर सके, क्योंकि वो लड़ाई तो नहीं कर सकते थे. सो दे डेवलप्ड अ सेल्फ डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म ऑफ रिजिड रिलीजियस प्रैक्टिसेस एंड ऑर्थोडॉक्सीज. सो ऑन वन हैंड व्हाट हैपेंड वाज that the common masses were oppressed by foreign rule, and on the other hand, by the strict and narrowing orthodox Hindu system. So they had to go nowhere. And दोनों तरफ से उनके लिए मुश्किल थी, उनको कठिन लगता था कि वो क्या करें ऐसे समाज में जहाँ एक तरफ हिंदू धर्म भी अपने को एक छोटी छोटी शाखाओं में बांट रहा है और मुस्लिम्स भी जो है वो उनके ऊपर कठोर होते चले जा रहे हैं. सो दे फेल्ट वेरी हेल्पलेस. सो एट दिस जंक्चर द भक्ति पोएट्स ट्राइड टू स्ट्रेंथन द इंडियन सोसाइटी फ्रॉम विदिन मींस व्हाटएवर वैल्यूज वर देयर इन आवर हिस्ट्री इन आवर कल्चर दे वांटेड टू स्ट्रेंथन दैट सो दैट द मासेस डोंट फील हेल्पलेस. सो इग्नाइटिंग अ सेंस ऑफ प्राइड इन टू देम बाय इन्वोकिंग द मंत्र एंड द लेजेंड ऑफ राम बाय डिस्क्राइबिंग हिज वर्च्यूज एंड डीड्स. They looked into history and they found Valmiki is Ram. So they wanted to present Ram in a new avatar form. So this, I'll come to that later. So this pan-India movement is what we call Bhakti Andolan, kind of a revolution, okay? Of which Kabir and Meera are the parts. They are very important parts. So what I was saying was that the Hindu society was losing its self-esteem, or we may say Swabhiman, and was going through a tough phase of identity crisis. Okay, so this desperate situation is depicted by the great saint, again I'll quote Tulsidas here, in one of his works called Kavita Vali. You want to understand what is Kavita? Kavita is the poetry. So Kavita Vali, he says about those times very clearly. I will say it in Hindi and I will explain it in English as well. Kheti na kisan ko. Kisan means the farmer is not getting any kheti. He's not getting any farming. Bhikhari ko na bhik, and the beggar is not getting any alms. Banik ko banijna, the businessman is not getting any business. Chakar ko chakri. Chakar means the servant. Servant is not getting anything to do. So jeevika vihin log sidhyaman soch vas kahe ek ekan so kaha jai ka kare. जीविका यू नो द जिसको कहते हैं आपका काम आपकी जॉब. सो सब लोग जॉबलेस हो गए हैं. एवरीबॉडी इज जीविका विहीन. नोबडी हैज एनीथिंग टू डू. एंड व्हाट दे आर डूइंग दे आर आस्किंग ईच अदर कहे एक एकन सो माने एक दूसरे से कहते हैं पूछते हैं कहाँ जाए क्या करें माने हम क्या करें कहाँ जाए. दिस इज वेरी वेरी विविडली एक्सप्लेन इन तुलसीदास कविता वाली. सो टू रिवाइव द इंडियन कॉन्शियसनेस and to save the society from disintegration, the poets looked into history and presented the story of Valmiki's Ram into a new avatar form, which is a superhuman figure. Now, Valmiki's Ram is a normal prince, a human being, but in Bhakti Kal, he is worshipped as a god who is embodiment of all virtues. So the reference to Ram we find in all the Bhakts is in so many forms. Kabir's Ram is nirgun, formless, but Tulsidas's Ram is with form, sagun. Okay, so there are basically two kind of forms which Ram was looked into, is sagun and nirgun. So I hope you all understand what sagun and nirgun is. But the beauty, Kabir's Ram is nirgun and Tulsi's Ram is with form, that is sagun. But they coexist. without any animosity and without any tussle. There is no conflict between the two kind of gods, Sagun and Nirgun, in this period, which is very rarely found in any other era. So this mutual acceptance is the core and the essence of bhakti movement, which I think is very rare, because the poets, the purpose of the poets was not to impose one's supremacy, not to impose their ideas on each other, but to help the masses whichever way possible. So this is the beauty of this movement, that despite many forms of God which were worshipped in this era, we don't find any of the poets hammering each other or just criticizing each other or bringing each other, others' values down. Similarly, like Ram Krishna Bhakti, also developed by Saguna poets, and by which Meera Bai is a very important part, and we'll discuss later the beauty of Meera's poetry. The importance of this vast movement is that it cuts across all the religions, castes, and communities, and transcends the boundaries of even male and female biases, as we see in the case of Meera Bai. On one hand, we find Kabir, Dadu, Redas, Rahim singing the praise of Nirgun Ram. And on the other hand, Tulsidas, Sur Das, and the Saguna poets, all these are geniuses in their own fields, but none tries to overthrow the other to establish himself. This is the beauty of this era. Even again, Tulsidas says here that Agunahi Sagunahi Nahi Kachu Bheda. I hope you understand. I'll say it in Hindi. Agun means Nirgun, and Sagun mein koi bheda nahi hai. Difference, koi antar nahi hai. Ubhay harahi bhava sambhav kheda. Both of these forms, both of these forms of God save you from the perils of this life. Bhav is sansar, kheda means duk, ubhay means both. Harna mane le lena. Ubhay harahi bhava sambhav kheda. So whether you worship Nirgun, whether you worship Sagun, both of them take the perils of the life, and they save you from the this world which is full of distrust. So in this context, we come to Kabir now, the simple weaver of Banaras and supposedly illiterate genius, as he has himself confessed in one of his lines. He has said, "Masi kagad chuyo nahi, kalam gayo nahi haath." Masi means ink. Kagad is the kagas, paper. So I have not touched, have never touched ink and paper. And kalam gayo nahi haath means never held a pen. But a seeker of truth that he was, he brought forth the wisdom that even today very few can match. He exposed the Hindu and Muslim orthodoxy, hypocrisy, violence, greed, and stupidity. And simply said very clearly that one of his lines is, "Jati paati puche nahi koi, hari ko bhaje, so hari ka hui." Very simple. He says, who is asking for jati? Nobody asks the caste and the creed. Why should you ask about the caste of a person? One who worships the God is the one who God embraces. So eventually, he criticized both Hindus and Muslims for their absurd ways. One of his lines, he says, "Are in do un raah na paai," means "Are ye dono jo hai rasta bhool gaye hain." Hindus and Muslims, dono ne rasta kho diya hai. They have lost their ways. Hinduan ki hinduai dekhi, Turkan ki Turkai. Maine Hinduon ka Hindupan bhi dekh liya. And Turkon ki Turkai bhi dekhi. He did not take any sides. He said both Hindus and Muslims have lost their ways and have seen both. Both are misleading the society. So don't fall prey to them. So we see Kabir that he insisted on penetrating everything that was non-essential, false, and delusive. Truth is within and not outside. He often insisted that you should look inside your soul, inside your consciousness, and that is where you will find God. If we all know about Kabir, if somebody has read him thoroughly, We often find a reference in Kabir's poetry, Ghat Ghat Mein Hai Ram. In every person, in every vessel, Ram is there. Ram resides. He is very close. He is simple. And there is no difference between him and us. The difference between him and us disappears as soon as we look within us. And he is so close, as just like the smell of a musk in a deer's navel. He has given beautiful examples to show how close the God is to a man. In one of his examples, I will first tell you in English. He says that the deer searches. The deer, you all know, we call Hiran. He searches everywhere for the smell of the musk. But he cannot find it. And because he doesn't realize that it has come from him only. In his navel, the kasturi is there. You all know kasturi. It is in the deer's musk. It is musk. It is his deer's navel. So one of his lines says, kasturi kundali base, mrig dhunde ban mahi. The kasturi is in the kundali, means navel of the deer. But he searches here and there in the whole forest. ऐसे घट घट राम है दुनिया देखे ना ही. मीन्स घट घट माने हर जगह राम रहते हैं कस्तूरी की तरह, पर दुनिया उनको देख नहीं पाती. ओके, सो दिस इज अ ब्यूटीफुल एग्जांपल ऑफ शोइंग दैट योर गॉड इज पर्सनल, हिज गॉड इज सिंपल. यू कैन स्मेल हिम, बट टू फाइंड हिम यू शुड सर्च योर कॉन्शियसनेस, लुक विद इन योर सेल्फ. सो ही स्कॉर्न्ड एट द पंडित्स हु मिसलीड द पीपल एंड चैलेंज And then challenge the pandits in the heart of Banaras. He had these guts to challenge the pandits and says, "Tu kehta kagad ki lekhi, main kehta hu aankhan dekhi." Now you can understand. He says to the pandits that what you are saying is kagaj ki lekhi. It is written in the kagaj. The scriptures are the kagaj. Okay, and what I am saying, aankhon ki dekhi. See. I tell you by my personal experience, what I have seen with my eyes, and you narrate from the kagas, that is the scriptures. So he was very blunt in expressing his ideas. So we observe that of all the poets of that era, Kabir gets very personal in his address to the audience. Why? Because he wants them to be attentive and to listen. We all are very familiar with this popular phrase, Kahat Kabir Suno Bhai Sadho, Kahat Kabir Suno Bhai Santo. So the emphasis here is on Suno, Samjho, Phir Karo. Okay, just like a friend narrating to his friend, and then he's saying, Suno Bhai Sadho. First he, you know, draws your attention to listen to what he's saying. And then he provokes us with his intelligent and skillful questions and tells to figure out the answers ourselves. He doesn't, draws our attention to the atrocities, and then tells us to find the answers ourselves. Sometimes people wonder why Kabir is so popular and sung even today. His verses are so strong and direct. That is because of his probing style, where he ruffles up things and then draws the things out like a magician. Because he's so personal, he's fearless and disarms others with his riddles and clever themes. For this, he uses a very powerful tool, that is his language. Understand him by all, or everybody understands what Kabir is saying. His language is called a Sadhukkari Bhasha. Sadhukkari means Sadhuon ki Bhasha. Which is a mix of Avadhi, Braj, Rajasthani, Khadi Boli, etc. And he totally dismantled this idea that the literature can only be written in Sanskrit and not in any other language. See, he with his own style, he says, Sanskrit hai koop jal, bhasha behta neer. I'll again repeat, Sanskrit hai koop jal. All the Bangla students, you understand yes, Sanskrit very well. I mean, Bangla is so close to Sanskrit, so you'll be understanding this. Sanskrit hai koop jal bhasha behta neer. Sanskrit is like a water in the well. It is stagnant.
It doesn't, it that not doesn't flow. It stays in one place. And bhasha, or the language of the commons, is like an overflowing, ever-flowing, ever-changing water, which takes everything in its fold. So his idea was to reach the audience through simplest but most powerful language and portray the truth by cleverly sketched examples of everyday life. I will give you only a few examples there here because it's a very vast samudra. Kabir's Vani is full of such examples. I picked a few to narrate his ideas. So I'll give a few examples. Now, Kabir gave a lot of importance to Guru and placed him even before God. Because he says the Shabd or the word from Guru shows the path to reach the Supreme. Okay. So in one of his Doha, he very beautifully describes how the Guru or the teacher nurtures the disciple. Kaise Guru apne shishya ko gadhata hai, banata hai, usko shape deta hai. Okay. How he nurtures his vidyarthi. It's a very beautiful quote. He says, Guru kumhar shishya kumbh hai, gadhi gadhi kaadhe hai khot. Guru kumhar shishya kumbh hai. Kumbh means ghada. Gadhi gadhi, ghada is a pot, a earthen pot. Gadhi gadhi kaadhe khot. Antar haath samhar de bahar bahe chot. Now I'll explain it in English. That Guru is like a potter and the disciple is like an earthen pitcher. Just like a potter when he makes his vessel, on one hand supports the clay from outside to give this shape, and by the other hand he removes its impurities and hits it very, very gently to make it strong. So this is a very specialized task and not everybody's cup of tea. Not everybody can be a guru. Some upper guru has to nurture and as well as tell the shishya about his faults as well, very gently. So this is a beautiful example which we have we found in this Kabir's poetry, that guru has this skill to weed out the imperfections and shape the disciple's life into a very, very perfect form. And there is another example which Kabir has given to express the feeling of God. How do we express when we see God or when we anubhav God, when we experience God? So he compares the experience of God with like sugar in a dumb person's mouth. You know, if you give sugar to a dumb person who cannot speak, he will just eat the sugar and smile. If you ask what is the taste, he will just smile because he cannot speak. So his lines are, Akath kahani prem ki, kachu kahi na jaye. Akath mane, jo kahi nahi ja sakti. Kahani means the story, prem ki. God's love is like an untold story. Jiske baare mein hum kuch bhi nahi keh sakte. Bhoonge keri sharkara, baithe muskai. Okay, he only smiles and is speechless, unable to express the feeling and the pleasure of oneness with God. Just like a dumb man cannot express the, taste of sugar, he just smiles happily. Such is the experience of God. So here he is so philosophical and we can say he reveals the depths of God experience so beautifully in these lines. So this is a very nice example which I have given you. But when he wants to shake the orthodoxy of, here he feels, we can see him like a philosopher and he has a soft approach about Guru, Shishya and the God's experience. But it is not the one style he followed. When he wants to, shake the orthodoxy of both the faiths, he is very blunt and he is very direct. Like in one of his poems, he says, Kakar Pathar Jod Ke Masjid Lai Banaye Kapar Mulla Bang De Kya Behra Hua Khudai. You know, he says about the mullahs that they just go on the rooftop of a masjid and shout like a cuckoo, like a cock,
And do you think that he cannot hear? The God needs to be shouted at.
Why do you shout on the top of a masjid? God is hearing everything. So, behra nahi hai wo. Behra hua khuda hai. He's asked question. Do you think God is deaf? He can't listen. So, here he is very blunt, very direct. And similarly for Hindus, he says, one of examples is very blunt, like, mood mudaye hari mile, har koi le mudaye, bar bar ke mudte, bheda na baikhunt jaye. It is in English, I can explain. Mood mudaye means, why you shave your head again and again, repeatedly? If that is the way to reach God, then the sheep will definitely reach first. I mean, you should not shave your head repeatedly to reach God. If that is the thing, the sheep, you know, we get the wool from the sheep every time. So she will be the first person to go to God. Here is very direct. And he did not even spare his own son for his wavering mind and greed for money. Maybe you all know that Kabir had a son and a daughter. And his son was not following the righteous way. And he started accumulating a lot of money and not following the right way. So he told about his son, like, but there is one line, Buda Vansh Kabir Ka Upja Poot Kamal. He's very sad here. Hari Ka Sumiran Chhod Ke Ghar Le Aaya Maal. Ghar Le Aaya Maal means he has started gathering wealth and money, and he has lost his sense of justice. He has lost the ways of God, and he has started bringing money home, which is not good. So he did not spare his own son when it comes to honesty and righteousness. So we can say that this radical honesty of Kabir abruptly jolts and shakes us from slumber and compels us to face things without fear. His works are full of many such examples where his socio-satirical poems completely takes people off guard and push them to an edge and then tone up their minds to develop insight for a greater truth, which can be reached or conceived by love or prem, as we say. I know you must all have heard his very popular doha about prem, about love. And he very subtly expresses what love is. He says, Pothi pad pad jag hua, pandit bhaya na koi, dhai akhar prem ka, padhe so pandit hoi. He says, there is no use in reading books. Pandits are reading so many books every day and narrating about gods, and yet they are fighting. Okay. There is no use in reading books. Pothi pad pad jag mua. Mua means bad. They are not good. They read scriptures every day, but they don't understand the dhai akhar. Dhai means two and a half. Two and a half letter word of prem. If somebody understands the two and a half letter prem, the word prem, then that is the love and compassion to the fellow human being. So you will understand what pandit is. A real pandit is who understands the meaning of prem. So he says that love is beyond boundaries. Even the entire universe and the world are like a family or a kutum, as is very aptly expressed in all of you must have been hearing about this Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. It is one of the shlokas in the Mundaka Upanishad. I will narrate here the two lines from which this slogan is taken. It is, Ayam nijaha paro veti gadana lagu chetasam udar charitanam tu vasudhaiva kutumbakam. See, this is for people who are above the narrow calculations of mine and yours. The entire earth is a family. This is what vasudhaiva kutumbakam is. So in Kabir's Banis, Sakhi, Shabdi, this tenet is found everywhere. And that is the biggest gift to the mankind he has given. To rise above small petty differences and to reach and look within. Have a udar charit, this line says ki udar chaitanam tu vasudhaiva kutumbakam, those who have accomplished those who are filled with compassion, those who are filled with love, those who have broad mind, udar charit, for them only the entire world is a like a kutum. So that is what Kabir also wanted to spread through his bhajans. Now this essence of love, devotion, dedication and empathy is the core thrust of the entire bhakti movement, and as I referred to in the beginning, it emerges as the most prominent and strong element of Mirabai's Padavali as well. Unlike most poets of this era, Meera's time and her family's life is a bit better known. Okay, so she belonged to the royal family of Mewar, which there is a place called Kudki in 16th century, and she was married with a royal family. Her husband was Bhojraj, and it is believed that after Bhojraj's demise, she devoted herself completely to Krishna Bhakti and spent most of her life in Vrindavan. And her bhajans are full of passion and longing to be with Krishna. In Bhakti tradition, we call this Kanta Bhav or Dampatya Bhav. The form of Bhav which is found in Meera's poetry is called Dampatya Bhav, in which the devotee adores God as a lover. And the pain of separation is depicted as viraha or vipralambhashanga. Viraha is the separation from the loved ones. It is also a very, it forms a very important part of Meera's poetry. So Meera's longing for Krishna was so intense and strong that she defied all the narrow constraints of social bonds. And we see her emerging as a strong woman with her own mind and identity. She is as open as blunt as Kabir is in openly expressing her deep love, which knows no boundaries. She acknowledges none other than Krishna and says, Mere to Girdhar Gopal, dusro na koi, jaake sir mor mukut, mero pati soi. I have only Girdhar Gopal, none other. He is the one who I am married to. So, Meera left this mundane world at a very, very early age to devote herself to God. And she was persecuted for this decision. She refused to accept her marriage, claiming to be already married to God and thus condemning the potentially powerful role as the wife of the heir to the throne. This was not an easy task at those times, which we all can understand and we can all assess today. A woman leaving her marital home, wandering and chanting bhajan, sitting in the company of sadhus were highly abhorrible. But she accepts all these challenges, saying, Tat mat bandhu bhrat, aapno na koi, chhaadi dai kul ki kaani, ka kari hai soi. Means, I have overcome the fear of kul. Chhaadi dai kul ki kaani. Kul ki kaani means kul ka dar. The fear of the kul I have overcome. Okay, and I'm not worried about the family lineage. Let's see, what harm can anybody do to me? Koi kya bigaad lega? Ka kari hai koi means what worst can a person do to me? Because I'm fearless. These are very brave words of a strong character in a male-dominant society. So, it was her intense love for Krishna which gave her this courage to defy the rigid norms of a narrow-minded society. Now, there is a very popular legend or a story associated with Meera, and it is often referred to her to show her views about bhakti. So I will try to tell it to all of you here as well. It is said that wandering here and there and singing the praise of Krishna, she wanted to meet Madhavacharya of this Bhakti Sampradaya. Some people say it was Madhavacharya, some say it was Surdas, but he was a male Bhakt
and she wanted to meet Madhavacharya and you know share her views. So she wanted to meet the saint, but it was she went. She asked the saint that I would like to meet you, okay? But the saint refused to meet her and said that I don't meet women. And she refused to meet Meera. Meera tried to meet him, but again he said that no, I don't. Number of times she tried, but he refused to meet. Then Meera sent this message that I thought there is only one male in this srishti. Mujhe main sochti thi srishti mein keval ek hi purush hai, and that is Krishna, and all the other all others are his gopis. There is only one purush, only one shakti, that is Krishna, and there is no other person, purush or stri or kuch nahi hai, keval Krishna hi ek purush hai, keval Krishna hi sansar ka ek mat purush hai, baki sab unki sakhiyan hain. On hearing this, the arrogance of that sadhu was immediately, it disappeared, vanished, because Meera had put forth her views and ideas of God very, very clearly. यहाँ कोई बनावटीपन नहीं है, दिखावा नहीं है. स्त्री पुरुष में जब ईश्वर भेद नहीं करता तो मनुष्य क्यों भेद करता है, ये विचार बहुत विनम्रता से और कुशलता से सामने रखा गया है. When the God makes no difference between male and female, then the why human beings are making difference between the female and male and not meeting me. So, इसे हम सब समझ सकते हैं कि मीरा का मानसिक धरातल कैसा था. What was her mental structure like? एक तरह से मीरा भी हमें कबीर की तरह ईमानदार, बेबाक और सत्यवादी दिखाई देती है. She is honest and candid in her expression of intimate and personal relationship with God. So, in doing so, she gives the reader an insight into her individual frame of experiences, which mirror her pain and delight at the same time. And she immersed herself completely in Krishna. Her longing for him never faded. It never fades. Unki kavitaon mein hum jaisa samarpan, tanmayata, tallinta dekhte hain, waisi bahut kam kaviyon mein paayi jaati hai. Unki poetry is like bhav pradhan. भावना प्रधान है, तन्मयता है उसमें. जैसे आप चैतन्य महाप्रभु की गीतों में पाते हैं, वो तन्मय है, विभोर है, कृष्ण की आसक्ति में खोए रहते हैं. ही नोज नथिंग एक्सेप्ट कृष्णा. तो हम एक तरह से कह सकते हैं कि मीराबाई हिंदी साहित्य की चैतन्य है, और आपके जैसे बांग्ला में चैतन्य महाप्रभु है, उसी तरीके का प्रेम और भावनाएं हमें उनके गीतों में मिलती है. एंड उनके गीत इतने भाव प्रधान हैं कि हम उसमें उनके सारे जो गीत हैं वो अलग अलग राग और रागिनियों में बांधे गए हैं. हर सॉन्ग्स आर सो फुल ऑफ इमोशंस दैट दे हैव बीन संग बाय ऑल द ग्रेट सिंगर्स लाइक एम एस सुब्बलक्ष्मी एंड एज वी ऑल नो लता मंगेशकर एज वेल शी हैज संग हर सॉन्ग्स एंड दे आर सो पॉपुलर इवन टूडे दैट दे टेक अस टू द हाइट्स ऑफ रिनंसिएशन. हर फीलिंग्स कैन बी summarized in her own words that Meera says about her love to Krishna, na main janu aarti vandan, na puja ki reet, hai anjani daras diwani, meri pagal preet. Leeri maine do naino ke deepak liye sanjoye, heri main to prem diwani, mera dard na jaane. The meaning is, I have lit my eyes as lamps and I am mad or insanely mad in my love for Krishna. So much of in love with Krishna, the pain of which nobody knows. I cannot express my love for Krishna because I have lit up my eyes with his love. And I'm anjan. Hai anjani. I don't know myself. Who I am. I am anjan. I am ignorant. I am very simple, naive, and know nothing about puja and aarti and all these. But I am desperately want to see Krishna. Main to prem diwani, mera dard na jaane koi. We can assess from these lines. There are so many poems of Meera where she has openly criticized the orthodoxy and male-female biases and all in her poetry. But because of the paucity of time here, I'm not able to narrate all of them. But to summarize my lecture, I will again say that both Kabir and Meera, both of these poets immensely helped the society of those times in dismantling the orthodoxy and hypocrisy of those times. And unka apna unique tarika tha. Both had their own unique way to show the right way to the society. And they taught us to forget petty differences and gather under the huge umbrella of compassion that is bhakti. So I have tried to very briefly draw your attention to these two poets. And bahut kuch kaha ja chuka hai Kabir aur Meera ke bare mein. And there is a lot of scope also to say so many other things about these great poets, because they are not small poets. They are great poets of the Bhakti Kal. So now I would like to say only this, that during those times and during those tough times of the medieval period, these poets were silently working towards bringing the Indian consciousness together, making the people realize about the importance of love and reviving the common language. That was the most important contribution, to revive the movement with the local language understandable by everything. Aap sabko main again main dhanyawad deti hu. I really want to thank the college, your prestigious college, for calling me for this lecture. Would one day like to meet with you personally to visit Calcutta, and you also are welcome to Delhi whenever you want, and we shall all have many such sessions together. That is my wish. Thank you all again for calling me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. I must confess that it was a very interesting and lucid presentation from your end. And I hope our students have gained immensely. It was actually a pleasure to have such an erudite scholar to address us on Bhakti cult. Rightly said, ma'am. Yes, sandwiched, you know, between foreign rule, oppression of the foreign rule, and the traditional caste hierarchy of the Brahmanism that was so prevalent in India. People sought refuge. They were seeking for respite. And it was the Bhakti movement that gave that solace and also prevented the society from getting fragmented. Yes, ma'am, you have again rightly said that was a period of poets and great saints who were working silently to bring about certain modifications and reforms in the society, which was in some way or the other was affected by the foreign rulers or from within due to the caste hierarchy. Yes. And these poets tried to rewrite Ramayana of Valmiki, or paint Ram of Valmiki. But yes, there was no conflict between Nirguna and Saguna. And there was no imposition of one another's ideas upon others. They all tried to arouse the consciousness of man. And one very important thing that we find is, yes, they tried to repeatedly, you know, put forth that external inhibitions and beliefs, they were all false, meaningless. And one needs to find access to one's inner self, that is the Atma Gyanam, as mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. So, and the languages were so lucid, so popular, that they used for the betterment of the commoners, so that the commoners may get enlightened and just form a pattern of life that could be little relaxing and comfortable. And as you said that there was reputation of saying such ghat ghat mein Ram hai, and here as we can mention about Kabir mentioned about Ram, but that Ram was never historical figure, the son of Dasharatha, but it was formless, eternal, the eternal being, the supreme being, God. Who was omnipresent, and different rituals, I mean bhakti movement was entirely against the rituals that were practiced by people. And yes, it was correct that then you need a liberal mind, mental faculty to practice Vasudeva Kutumbakam. And again in Meera we find Mere to Giridhari Gopal Dusra Na Koi. So much of devotion, truly. And what I find more interesting is in those days, a woman having her own ways. It was really amazing. It was fascinating.
Expressing her ideas, that was amazing.
You know, she was so immersed in God that she did make a mark of herself as a true bhakt. But in those days, speaking about and practicing gender equality, you know, that was a very progressive mind. It was a symbol of a very progressive mind. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was so informative. I'm sure my students have benefited immensely, and thank you. Hope to hear you much more later when everything gets normal, and hope to meet you in person too. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much. Thank you again. Namaskar.
Namaskar.
रूपा में